Okay, it looks like we're live now. If you guys can let me know what area you are from, that'd be awesome. I'm from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. Any Saskatoon, Saskatchewan folk here? Zone 3 folk or USDA Zone 4. Very, very close to the same. Very, very close to the same. I'd be excited to know. I am, what, right now it, fun story. So right now it is like minus 13. Yesterday it was plus 2, and then the day before that it was like minus 30 something. So talk about a nightmare when it comes to headaches and colds and all that fun stuff. But the soil is most definitely compacted and frozen right now, so we don't get to go outside and have fun, but we'll have lots of fun indoors still nonetheless. If you're new to the Lee Valley Lives, we come on here and we basically talk about science-based gardening and houseplant care tips. So my name's Ashley, and I'm the host of the Gardening in Canada YouTube channel, website, all that fun stuff. And I actually got a degree in soil science from the University of Saskatchewan and the College of Agriculture and Bioresources. So I know a lot about soil science, and then I have a minor in plant science, so I do have a little bit of an understanding about plant science as well. And I like to take all that science and apply it to plants or to the garden or to house plants, whatever the case is. So don't be scared to drop questions down below. I'd be more than happy to take them. There's no such thing as a stupid question. Trust me, I'm a scientist, so every question is valid. I believe anything is possible. But let's check who's in. We have Ottawa, Fredericton, Northwood, Ontario, Calgary. We're almost coast to coast. We're missing BC. Paradise. That sounds like a beautiful place. You down for adopting a redhead? Burlington, Ontario. Cool. Cape Breton. So we have a lot of like zone 5, zone 6 type people. Charlottetown. Cool. We need someone from BC. Someone in BC has to speak up in the comments, and then we're coast to coast. Oh, we got Saskatoon. Okay. Let's geek out, Northern Grower. Yes, let's do it. Okay, we're gonna get started. Today we're talking about soil micro activity, how to encourage it. If you're an indoor gardener or a house plant person, this applies to you. If you're an outdoor person, this applies to you. And we're going to be talking about how even microbes can help actually prevent against disease and bugs, just pests in general. So this is really going to set you up both indoors and outside. Let's just jump straight into this. So if you guys did not know, one of the really main reasons for why you want a microbially sound soil is nitrogen or nutrient cycling in general. So there's a whole bunch of cycles that take place in our soil, and most of it is done by microbes. Nitrogen cycle, for example, has nitrifying and denitrifying bacteria. The phosphate cycle, for example, has phosphate solubilizing bacteria, and it's just a whole lot of bugs. So if you're a houseplant person, a really common issue I have, or I find that people have, is the idea of having bugs indoors. And I want you to think of this as something completely different. You're not going to see any of these bugs, and the bugs you have in your home, if you have pest issues or if you have nutrient issues, is likely because you have the wrong bugs present. So while you may think your soil looks sterile and that there's nothing in it, if you're having issues, it's likely you have the wrong kind in your house. So, for example, root rot that you have in houseplants is a great example of a bad bacteria that exists. It's actually a bacteria that thrives without the presence of oxygen. So, lack of oxygen equals root rot for the most part. So, let's look at what it takes to make this happen. So I have a whole bunch of products down here in front of me. And the main thing that we want to do when we have a aiming for a microbially active soil, whether it's indoors or outside, is the addition of carbon. So when we add carbon to our soil, we end up with higher rates of microbial activity, we end up with something called higher rates of cation exchange capacity, which is essentially the soil's battery ability, its ability to hold on to nutrients. And then we also end up with a whole host of formations. So the soil's ability to have a solid formation, which ultimately can save us from things like compaction, for example. So when we look at adding carbon, there are a lot of products out there that we can use, one of which is, for example, this is a Canadian company, but humic acid. Humic acid is a form of carbon that can be added to the soil. Now, for the houseplant people, this is probably the more ideal method because you're doing it on a very small scale. Container gardeners as well, with peat moss, for example, type-based soilless mediums, having a humic acid is going to be of value for you. So there's a lot of information out there about humic and fluvic acids, and I'm here to tell you that as a soil scientist, we don't quite understand what's in a humic acid or in a fluvic acid. We haven't been able to isolate it in nature, but we can kind of sort of replicate it in the lab. And the way that we do that is we apply highly alkaline substances to organic material. So the organic material we use in most cases to make humic acid is either really dark peat, so the stuff that's at the bottom of our peat bogs, or we use laterite. Now, that is a coal seam that we find in nature. So it is derived from coal in some cases. So that may or may not be something you want to watch out for. The good news is, even if it's derived from coal, it's still considered organic. It's still honorary certified. So just a fun fact there. Another way we can add things such as carbon, which again, that's our main goal when it comes to building a soil that is microbially active and healthy enough to support microbes, is through the addition of manure. So there's different ways to do this, or compost for that matter. If you're a gardener outside, you're going to place a layer of manure down, and then you're going to want to put your compost on top. If you don't place compost on top of manure, we end up with gassing off from that manure, which is actually one of the main sources for some emissions into our atmosphere in some cases, which isn't a bad thing. We just have to manage it a little bit differently. The other way to do it would be in a houseplant setting. Now, for those houseplant people out there, one thing you'll notice is if you add a top dressing of manure to your plants, you will end up with hydrophobicity. So you'll end up with a repelling of water and kind of a pooling or a floating of the manure, the compost, on the surface of your soil. But if you still want to add that carbon to the system so you can have microbes that will actually cycle your nutrients, then you could add something such as a granular manure, which does exist, which doesn't have that hydrophobicity because it's simply a compact version of the looser stuff. So that is something to add as well that you can try out. Now you're probably wondering, when it comes to adding carbon, what's the purpose of it? Wouldn't you be adding microbes to it? And the truth is that soils can either hold the microbes and make them happy, or they can release the microbes. So the way that the microbes are harmed in the presence of soil is through the introduction of oxygen, heat, or lack of moisture. So if we have a container that is getting a soil heat that is much too high, then we end up cooking our microbes. That's probably the most obvious. But the second way is through the exposure of that soil to light and oxygen. So if we till our soil, or if we turn it over, we're exposing that bottom, the top segment of soil to air and to light, and this will neutralize or kill off not only the microbes, but it will oxidize our carbon, making CO2, which is something we're all too familiar with. So when we end up with CO2 emissions from the soil through tillage, obviously we're having the opposite effect, and we're potentially damaging an area that is needed, that's usually happy for microbes, that isn't any longer. Now, I'm not saying for some cases, for heavy clay soils, or clays or soils that are holding on to excess moisture and has a lot of compaction issues, you may need to till at some points in time just to move in products such as gypsum or lime to cause something we call flocculation. So it's actually our clay particles separating from each other and kind of making blocks that allow for roots and nutrients to pass through. And this is kind of like a reclamation of the soil. Now, naturally, soils can be compact and naturally, soils can be fluffy. So it may not be your fault in the way that you dealt with your soil in the past. It could be actually something we call parent material, which kind of is the brain behind or the memory to our soil. And in order to change that, it takes some different tasks. So if you guys have a specific soil that you want to talk about, or you want to talk about getting to a point that is self-sufficient in a sense, then be sure to leave that as a question and I'll be able to answer that for you. So I have one question about worms castings and if it works the same way. And I don't want to get into that too much, because if you checked out Lee Valley's live events, you know that there is a vermicompost live coming up and we're going to be talking all about that stuff. But yes, vermicompost is a way to add carbon. Now, with the manures, the compost, the vermicompost, green manures is another way. It's essentially lawn, like if you cut your lawn and it's still green, that's an example of a green manure. If you choose to use those forms of manure and you top dress with them, keep in mind while you think to yourself you're adding fertilizer, I'd rather you think of it as you're adding a soil amendment or a soil conditioner. So you're not just adding fertilizer, you're actually adding something that's going to make, kind of like a conditioner does, make your soil a better environment for that plant. So that's just something to keep in mind there. So besides the additions that we can add, this here, these are fertilizers. So these won't be considered adding carbon in the sense as some of these other ones that I spoke about, such as the humic acid and the manure compost, that sort of thing. This is more so a fertilizer. So this is immediately bioavailable fertilizer or food for those plants. So that's something to keep in mind. Adding this sort of stuff isn't going to help your microbe community as much as some of these other products or substances will. Now, besides the additions, there is the actual plants and what they do. So in farming, we talk about crop rotation often, and in gardening, we talk about crop rotation quite often as well. And so different plants have different abilities to actually absorb CO2 from the atmosphere. So if you look at this wall behind me right now, everyone's working in overdrive, even though we can't see what they're doing. This leaf, for example, is simply taking up the light, and then it's opening its stomatas, which are located on the bottoms of the leaves, and they kind of look like lips. And as those lips open up, they allow CO2 from the atmosphere to go into the plant. Once that CO2 enters the plant, it is kind of chopped up, the carbon is separated from the two oxygens, and it makes a carbohydrate. Similar to what we eat and we like all too much sometimes, it's exactly what the plant is doing. Now, 40%, and I personally find that number staggering and scary, but 40% of all carbon taken in by our plant is actually then put right back into our soil. So if we're crop rotating or changing the types of plants on our soil surface, whether it be in our pots or outdoors, we're actually helping change the dynamics of the carbon that's put into that soil. Some years it may be more, some years it may be less. Now, something to keep in mind, I've got lots of questions here. So another thing to keep in mind is the rhizosphere. So this is something you may want to Google after, because I can't really show you too much of what that looks like. But if you look at these pots here behind me, the top of the plant stops here, but underneath that, there's a whole bunch of roots. And the roots and the area around the roots is what we call the rhizosphere. So that carbon, that 40% of the carbon they take through the leaves that's then put into the soil, what happens is it actually comes out as a sugar. So what the roots are doing is they're putting out a McDonald's meal. And that McDonald's meal is going to attract all the microbes that that plant needs to survive and thrive. And the exudates that they do release, and that's the name of the McDonald's meal, the exudates they release attract different types of microbes. each of those microbes recycle different types of nutrients. So if the plant needs more phosphate, for example, the plant's going to release exudates that's going to call in the phosphate solubilizing bacteria. That's another reason why if we rotate our plants and we put different plants in different places, we end up with a more diverse rhizosphere, which is simply a fancy word for saying where the roots are. So that's another way to look at this. So I'm just going to take some questions here. Are word castings a source of carbon? Yes, they are. They are a source of carbon similar to that of a compost or manure, closer to compost, but yes, it is definitely. Natural ash is a good source of carbon. Yes. If we're talking like biochar type, charcoal type, that is exactly what is in the terra preta soils in the Amazon, for example. The mysterious terra preta soils that no one really knows too much about as soil scientists. Isn't organic fertilizer better than regular? So that's a great question. If you have a soil that's devoid of micronutrients, or sorry, devoid of microbiota, it won't really matter if you use synthetic or if you use organic. That's the reality. Because even your synthetic fertilizer that you add needs to be cycled. So the nitrogen in that synthetic fertilizer needs to be cycled into a realm that is digestible to the plant. Same thing goes with our organic fertilizers. Now, there are studies that have come out showing that the initial application of a synthetic fertilizer has reduce the colonies. They're called CFUs, colony-forming units of the microbiota within the soil. But they've tested it over time, and within 72 hours, and there's a caveat to this, within 72 hours, the soil microbiology has regained its position. The exception to this, and this is a big exception for all you container gardeners and the houseplant people, if you're fertilizing a closed system, something like this that's in a container, what ends up happening is you end up potentially, not always, but potentially sometimes, you'll end up wiping out all your microbes within your soil, sterilizing the whole thing. So there's nowhere for those microbes to recolonize from. So it can take longer than 72 hours for your houseplants or your container garden to jump back. And so that's another reason why you really want to focus on additives such as the manures, the compost, that sort of thing that's going to increase and diversify the microbiota that added. But you also want to make sure it stays at a heat and the moisture is nice and high. So those of you that are letting your houseplants dry out to bone dry, you're actually harming and distressing your microbiota in your soil. So if you want to organically fertilize your houseplants, it's really important that you keep that soil moisture at around a 20% is ideal. So, and if you want more information on that, then you should check out our last live stream that we just did, because we talked a whole bunch about that sort of thing. So I have nematodes. So, fungus, I have fungus bugs. So fungus gnats. So, nematodes, are a definite way to deal with this. So this is kind of more so the microbe side of things. So if we look at a soil that is diverse and happy, that's balanced, we end up being able to actually counter things like fungal, bacterial, and pest issues. So if we're able to keep our soil moisture nice and high and we have a lush environment high in carbon, then we can add things such as biological bugs. So here's a product I have, and they're kind of all the same, but this is a specific for fungus gnats, thrips, mealybugs, anything generated out of the soil that's usually in a houseplant community. And these are nematodes. And before you freak out, you can't see them. They're micro mini. Fun fact, if you were under a electron microscope, your entire body, and they scanned you and they removed your body and just left the nematodes that are present on your skin, your entire outline of your body would show up on the scan, just outlined by nematodes. You got a lot of them. So this is kind of what they look like. These look like eggs. They're not. It's just the vector in which these are carried. And all you do is you literally add them to your soil. So you just place them on top, you keep them nice and moist, and they will actually help counteract, in this case, fungus, gnats, thrips, that sort of thing. If you have issues with ants, if you have issues with slugs, snails, add some nematodes. You can get nematodes for all of those issues. And all they do, actually, they're probably the most interesting microbe on the planet. They are so tough. They've been around since the beginning of time, and they've survived ice ages, they've survived flooding, you name it. And what they do is they go and actually eat at the microbes in the environment. So I actually use these religiously in my vermicompost bin because it actually helps cut those out a lot. The other method you can take is the addition of bacteria. So a bit of a fun fact here, there is a bacteria and I don't want to mess up the name of it. So let me pronounce this properly. I phonetically spelt this out so I would not screw this up. Is it on this one? Okay, I have it. Bacillus thuringiensis. Bacillus thuringiensis. There's a product that's called BTK. I don't have it here. Also known as mosquito dunks. So that is actually a bacteria, and this goes back to that microbiome that I'm talking about. If this is in balance, we can really fight a lot of these things. Those mosquito dunks or the BTK or just that bacteria in general, what will happen is it will eat and consume things like mosquito larvae or fungus gnats, for example, and they do eat away at a variety of other pests and just completely destroy them. So that's kind of the value there. Same with the nematodes, protozoa, things like that. They'll eat away at fungal spores or harmful bacterial spores as well. So just something to keep in mind. The other one is lactobacillus. So I don't have it here. I completely forgot, actually. I meant to do it, but lactobacillus is, you can make this at home using white rice, water, and sugar. It's really easy to do. And I did a blog post on this. I think I even did a video on how to do this. But essentially, all you do is you put rice in a container and you leave it in the water. And the bacteria on the rice is actually lactobacillus. And when we have lactobacillus present in our compost or in our soil or houseplants, we end up with a whole host of benefits. So just the decomposition process and that cycling of nutrients is huge. So if you want to ever speed up your decomposition in your compost, in your vermicompost bin, or just in your houseplants, if you're a person that's adding things like manure or compost, or you're trying to keep it really organic with these organic fertilizers, for example, adding that lactobacillus is really going to give you a jump into cycling nutrients. You're going to see a huge spike there. So sea soil. Elaborate on that. Whoever asked about the sea soil question, elaborate on what that is. I'm not 100% sure. Sean on Facebook. I have compacted clay in my yard. I would prefer no-till. I lost you. I prefer no-till in my yard. I'm planning on trying to plant and leaving daikon radishes to break it up this year. So if you have a compacted soil, such as a clay soil, and I think anyone from Saskatchewan, Alberta, areas in Ontario, Manitoba, this is something, even Quebec, we deal with this a lot. The shores have more sandy issues, but here in the central portions of Canada, it's definitely a problem. And it's fun fact, because we were at the bottom of a giant lake. So since we're at the bottom of a giant lake, we ended up with nice clay material sitting there. So there are some things you can test to see if, for example, your daikon radishes, which, by the way, guys, great radish if you can get your hands on them, to really break up that clay soil. Do a compaction test. So I have, there's a way to do it, but all you do is you take a coat hanger and you do a grid. So see this grid here, and then you can list out your points in which you test. So all you take a do is take a coat hanger and you stick it in, and you see how far you can get the coat hanger into the ground. And then based on how the depth you get that coat hanger in will help you determine if that soil is compacted to a point that it needs to be maybe amended with a gypsum or a lime that has to be actually tilled in, or if a daikon radish will actually penetrate that. And the pressure in which a daikon radish can penetrate is actually quite high. It's up to 3,000 or 300 PSI. Yeah, so 300 PSI. So the perfect range is 0 to 200. But yeah, I would look up how to test that. The other way to determine if you can do a daikon radish method rather than a gypsum, a lime, or something that's more invasive would be to do a percolation test. So I have a picture here of what a percolation test looks like. And can you see it? Yeah. So it's basically you dig a hole and you stick water in it. And then you time how quickly that water moves out of the system. And that's a really good idea for anyone that has a dry spring and is expecting a wet summer. You don't want to plant radishes in a heavy clay soil. That's just going to simply flood, because then you wasted a whole growing year and reclamation on that soil. So perform those tests at home and it'll really help you out. So Carol on Facebook, clay soil, please. Even after years of adding compost on top, it is still a heavy layer below. Yes. So if you're simply adding a compost on top of a clay soil, what we end up with is something called a perched water table. So we've got this nice heavy clay soil, and we have this light fluffy kind of like manure compost on top. And what our water does is it comes through and it hits the clay, and then it peters out and it goes straight across, and it just kind of runs off and goes down. So because we can't penetrate that, we run into some issues. So our options are you put a raised bed on top of it, or you reclaim what's already present. So in a clay soil, what you want to try to do, especially when you're trying to promote a microbially active soil, because microbes are really going to help you achieve a fluffier soil just because of the activity that they have in there. But if you have a heavy clay, there's not a lot of oxygen movement in there, so the microbes can't thrive and survive, right? So if we add lime or gypsum, for example, to that soil, and we work it in a little bit, we don't have to work it in much. We can just do a nice low till method, maybe water it in, whatever you're comfortable with. We end up with flocculation. So our clay particles are like plates. So they sit like plates on top of each other. But when we add lime, for example, we end up with a repelling. So we end up with our clay particles pushing away against each other, because they're actually, it's a very unique soil type. It's magnetically charged. And so if we can make those poles push away from each other, negatively charge them, and they push away, it ends up with a little bit of a space there. Not much of one that we can even see by our eyes, but for a plant or for a microbe, it's a big deal. And so that'll help. So if you haven't added gypsum or lime, definitely give that a shot and let me know how it works out. But there's lots of different methods for that to help with that. Unfortunately, just compost and manure isn't going to solve that issue. So Twitch viewer says, hi, Kits Creation, Mechform, Sam Hung. Hey, how's it going, guys? Nova Scotia's soils are pretty much clay and rock. How it is possible to lighten it up and enrich. Yeah, so that's a miserable combination. Yeah, again, gypsum, lime, that sort of thing's really going to help them flocculate and push away from each other. So that's something that you should definitely look into. You need to make those clay particles repel. You don't want them to stick, right? So very important. Dawn on Facebook, how would you describe the difference between manure and compost? So they're actually pretty drastically different. So compost is really high in carbon, and it depends on the compost you're using. So if you have a leaf litter compost, your carbon to nitrogen ratio is drastically different than a vegetable grass compost, for example. So if you're trying to promote more fungal hyphae in your garden, which is something you, if you want the goal of sequestering carbon, and I wrote a stat down here for this. So 2.5 acres, which is about what most houses are on, can sequester up to 10 tons per year of carbon just on your just in your yard. That's how much tonnage you can sequester from the atmosphere if your soil is microbially active. And fungi is a great way to help sequester carbon. So there's one kind of fungal, hyphae fungal, and I don't want you to think of like mushroom. I want you to think of like fingerlings, kind of like the fuzzy stuff you find on the top of soil. That's hyphae. Think of that underground. There's one in the US that was found. It's estimated around 2,000 to I think 7,000 years old. It's the size of a football field. And that thing can sequester, I think it's like 300 tons of carbon a year. So if you have a compost that is heavy in leaf litter, then you actually are really promoting a lot of hyphae growth, a lot of fungal growth. If you stick with a more of a vegetable compost, then you're going to support more bacterial growth, for example. With manure, we kind of end up with a whole different kit and caboodle. It's essentially a manure that it has a carbon to nitrogen ratio that's valuable, but there's actually the micronutrient profile, and the manure is more so what you're interested in there. So, for example, sulfur is one that's really high in manure. And so, if you're growing Brussels sprouts, cabbage, mustard, anything in that brassicae species, broccoli, cauliflower, that sort of thing, you want to add more manures because the more manures you add, the higher content of sulfur you have. And the other thing with manure too is you want to don't just dump this on as much as you want. And same with compost, be reasonable about it. If you're pushing anywhere over 2 inches top dressing of either manure or compost in a year, you're probably over applying and you're causing eutrophication. So we have lots of people here from Ontario. You've got a lot of lakes by you, Quebec, a lot of lakes, bodies of water, that sort of thing. Manitoba, you got a lot of lakes, bodies of water. You really want to make sure you're limiting how much you're putting in. So runoff and eutrophication is an issue with both compost and manures. So keep it in under 2 inches on average, unless if you're getting soil tests and you're getting recommended rates in which to apply. If you know your recommended rate, then apply based on that. But just don't put too much. Sometimes I look at no dig and watch how much people pile on, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that's a lot of nitrogen runoff. But Sherry on Facebook, I have a heavy clay soil. What can be best carbon or soil amendment conditioner? Yeah, so with the clay soil, I would honestly, if I had a heavy clay soil that I was completely fed up with, I would do a layer of gypsum and lime and quite a bit of it. You're not going to hurt your plants by putting it in there. And I would do a light tilling, if it's a rake or a hoe, whatever the case is, and break it up and force that into the soil. And then I would do a layer of manure. I would do a layer of compost. And then I would do a layer of mulch. And I would keep it really nice and saturated. I'd do an inch of each type thing. And then I would plant into that with the daikon radishes for that first year. I think you'd be really impressed with how quickly that does break up. Now, you don't have to do just a whole garden of daikon radishes. You can interplant with daikon radishes. So you could do a row of daikons, and then you could do your tomatoes, and then you can do something maybe like a smaller pepper in front, and then daikons, and then layer them in. And it's really going to help your roots to move into that soil system. Question over on Face, Lena on Facebook. Question: I have a hydroponic one part nutrient that I used when I grew in LECA. I no longer grow that way. Can I use regular fertilizer on, use this as a regular fertilizer on my houseplants? If so, what would it be? Yes, you can. I just don't know what the dilution is. I would assume it's a capful, so around 5 milliliters per 1 gallon would be my guesstimate on that. But if you reach out to me or to Lee Valley with like a photo of the packaging, I might be able to help you out just a little bit more with that. So Sal on Facebook says, if you have barn cleanings with shavings and horse manure, will it work well in a vegetable garden? Now that's a good question. It will work on a vegetable garden. However, there is a zootrophic, I can't remember. It's basically the interface between humans and animals. You want to heat it to a point. So if you obviously have horses and you have bedding, start a compost pile and let it sit and let it get really, really hot. You should be able to see this thing steaming in the wintertime type thing. And that's really going to help kill off all the fungi and the bacteria that may be harmful in that pile. After that, what you may want to do is start a secondary compost pile where, and everyone should do this, by the way, and inoculate your compost pile, whether it is a manure compost pile or if it's a just a regular compost pile. Inoculate it with soil, and you don't need much, just a tablespoon from areas that are natural in your environment. So, if you know of a grassland in your area that is not a national park, because you will get in trouble, but if you know of a grassland that you can ask permission from the conservatory, for example, to take a teaspoon of soil from, go grab some from that grassland. Go grab some from your local forest. Again, asking permission. Grab a teaspoon from there. If you have a park, maybe that has natural aspen bluff, for example, grab some from there and look up all the different ecosystems in North America and try to achieve getting a soil from each one of those areas. Because each one of those areas have different types of bacteria and different types of fungi. And our gardens that we have at home, because they're so disconnected from the regular ecosystem, have an overabundance of invasive microbes, I guess you could say, in a sense, or ones that are not native. So when we buy things like mycorrhizal fungi or rhizobacteria, it's really another popular product that you can purchase, and we put those in our soils at home, they do relatively well for that growing season. But because they're not native to your area, even things such as atmospheric pressure, moisture, temperature will all actually affect how they colonize or survive our winters. So go into your local environment, grab inoculant soils, throw them into your compost, throw them into your manure, throw them into your vermicompost bin, and allow those microbes to build up. If you don't have access to a compost bin, maybe you're in an apartment or something of that in that sense, then start a 5 gallon pail of water, put a cup of sugar in, put that soil in like a cheesecloth bag, whatever it takes, stick it in the bucket over the side, get a bubbler and just bubble that water, introduce lots of oxygen, leave it for about a month or two, top it up with more water. If you can, distilled water, top it up every once in a while. And within a month, you're going to have a bucket of native microbe, soil microbes just hanging out in your living room. And then you can then use that to fertilize and treat all your plants. And you will be blown away by the results that you do see from that. So, Lindsay on Facebook. Oh no, I skipped Nikki. Sorry, Nikki. Nikki on Facebook, I have a large new garden that is very sandy topsoil, laid over a fairly compacted hill. Mulch was laid in the fall in order to amend the soil. Do I need to remove? That's a good question. Do I need to remove or move or remove slash move the mulch? That's a good question. So sandy soil, I feel so bad for you. It's worse than clay soil. I always hear about the clay soil people, but the sandy soil people have it way worse. There's a reason why the Sahara Desert does not have plants in it. So with the mulch, actually, if you have mulch on top of the soil surface, my university actually did a study on this. The first 2 inches, inch to 2 inches of soil has less nitrogen than the remainder of the soil. And the reason for this is because the microbes are going in to try to decompose. So that lactobacillus, all that fun stuff, is going in trying to decompose that mulch. So that first 2 inches or inch is devoid of nitrogen or lacks nitrogen. It's all kind of in a battery store right now that is not accessible by the plant. Now you're probably freaking out being like, oh my gosh, I killed my plant, or my plants aren't doing as well because they're lacking nitrogen. That's not the case. So what happens is in that first centimeter or inch of soil, again, depending on the type of soil you have, but that first little section is actually preventing weed growth, because the weeds are what germinate in that top layer. And this is why when we hear of people starting seeds in their garden, people will often say, remove your mulch every year, because if you start your seeds in that area where it's devoid of nitrogen, we may end up with stunted growth or poor rates of germination. So personally, I do remove my mulch only because I'm neurotic. You don't have to. If you incorporate that mulch into the soil through tillage or even low-till mechanisms, you are everywhere that mulch is, the interface between the mulch and the soil, you technically are restricting nitrogen. So if you get that into that root zone, into that rhizosphere we were talking about at the very beginning of the live stream, what ends up happening is we end up potentially starving our plants for nitrogen. So that's just something to keep in mind. Now, if you remove it, you're going to see better seed germination, especially for your seedlings, and just, you know, a healthier start. But once you get a few leaves and you know those roots have dug down a little bit, you can replace that old mulch even, or the new mulch back on top. And when you choose your mulch, just choose carefully. Either buy a brand, a name brand mulch, or go to a facility that sells mulch. In my city here in Saskatoon, anyone watching from Saskatoon, we have a city compost. And so we have our compost and then we have our mulch. And I personally, from that city compost, and they don't vet what goes into it. And there's this wonderful thing that plants do. It's not wonderful. Well, it's wonderful for them, not wonderful for us. But they release gases into the air and the surrounding soil area. And what ends up happening is our seeds don't germinate, is what it kind of, it's an area of inhibition, and it's just something that plants naturally do. So just something to keep in mind, make sure you get a good quality mulch that doesn't potentially have harmful plants in it. Things like eucalyptus actually, surprisingly, can hamper the germination of certain seeds. So Lindsay on Facebook, I would love to know how you would handle beds surrounded by trees. The soil is compacted, but anything loose add on top fills a tiny root. I require tilling to prevent, which requires tilling to prevent the plants from getting choked out. If you have a bed surrounded by trees and that's compacted, it's likely because of tree roots, not so much the soil type. I would do raised beds, or if you don't want to do raised beds because it may be uneven, I don't know what the situation is, garden socks, look them up, garden S-O-X-X. They're nylon socks that you put compost into or potting soil, and then you cut little holes in the nylon sock and then you plant into that, and you can put that around really difficult to plant areas. Unfortunately, with the trees, you don't obviously want to till, right? Because you will harm them. I gotta check my time. Okay, we're still good. So Marianne on Facebook, how about cow manure with sawdust and shavings? Is that okay for the garden? Totally fine. Totally fine for the garden. Like I said, it is a wood, so it goes into the same category of trees or mulch. So just, you know, make sure that with that, you're not causing any nitrogen to be sequestered in the decomposition of that product. So if you can put it to the side and really let it heat up and ferment, you always, whenever you're dealing with manures, the exception is maybe like a rabbit manure, but even then, whenever you're dealing with manures, you really want to make sure you're burning out any bacteria that may be in there. E. coli. The reason why E. coli exists is it's from poop. You don't want E. coli on your lettuce. Don't want that on your lettuce or your carrots. So let it really cook and cook out that E. coli. And like I said, you literally just look up videos on it. You pile it up on top of each other and you let it sit and you let it heat and you can rotate it every once in a while. But for the most part, you just let it sit, heat up, and you're done. They can get pretty warm though, so just keep that in mind. What is your thoughts on humic? We talked about humic at the beginning of the video. I am going to force you to go back and look that up. But basically what it is it's carbon substances that have been exposed to very alkaline product to give you humic acid. Not well understood by the scientific community. A ton of debate out on this product still and whether or not it's worth it. But ultimately it does add carbon, which helps your microbiota of your soil. What's the best acidity, best way to acidify soil for blueberries? Oh no, I knew this question was gonna come. So here's the thing. With soil pH, it is a pain in the butt because we have something in Canada or in North America, all over the world, we have something called parent material. And so our pH is heavily dependent on said parent material. So even if we amend our soil pH or we try to amend our soil pH in our specific area, we still will end up with that parent material kind of placing the trump card on top of it and nullifying whatever we try to do. So that's just the unfortunate part about this. But there's a ton of content on that. If you have more questions on it, Debbie, reach out to me. I can try to answer them for you. That's a long, long answer. Lots of different things you have to try. And it's actually based kind of on your parent material as well. How can you test if a soil is devoid of microbiota? That's my favorite question so far. So there's a beautiful test you can perform. It's called the microbe test. What you're going to do is you're going to go into your undie drawer. You're going to open it up and you're going to pick your oldest pair of cotton underwear or socks, if you don't want to scare the neighbors. You're going to weigh that on a weigh scale and you're going to record what that weight is. So you'll record your first weight right here or on a sheet of paper. And then you're going to put it in the ground. You're going to dig out your garden, little area in your garden. You're going to put your underwear, your socks in, and then you're going to put it the soil back on top. And you're going to leave it. You're going to put a flag on top, mark where it is. And then strategically, every 2 weeks, every month, you're going to dig up your underwear. You're going to dig up your socks. And then you're going to reweigh it and see how quickly it's decomposing in your soil. If you have healthy soil that is heavy in microbe activity, you will not have any underwear left by the end of the month. I can almost guarantee that. So long as it's obviously the temperatures are warm. So say you started this in July 1st, by August 1st, you should not have any underwear left. If you still have underwear left, then it's maybe time to think about how to readjust that microbe activity or try to bump it up. But the underwear test is, it sounds bizarre, but it is one of the best tests you can do. So Patricia on Facebook, can you speak to wood ash? Yeah, so that is the terra preta. That's really made famous from the terra preta soils. And so that's a great way to add carbon. It's a great way to increase your cation exchange capacity. It's a really great way to actually increase your water holding capacity as well. The unfortunate part is it usually works best if it's moved into the soil in some way. So if it's actually worked into a point. So if you're setting up a raised bed, it's a great idea to add it. Just make sure you research how much you're adding based on the area you're trying to fill. If you use too much, you can end up with negative effects, I find. I've personally found that to happen. So just something to keep in mind, but it is a great way to, it is a really great soil conditioner for sure. How are we supposed to know if it's at 20%, Bonnie asked. And the reason I say 20% is because there's something we like to call permanent wilting point. So that's the point in which the plant is unable to uptake any water, and that point is 20%. So you would have to get a moisture meter for your soil, or in some cases, if you can take a Q-tip and stick the Q-tip into your potting soil or into your container, and then pull it out, if it still feels like it's damp on the end, it's a great sign that it is still, that there's still some moisture in it. If it comes out sopping wet, obviously you don't have to water. If it comes out dry, it is definitely time to reevaluate and get some water stuck in there. So, my dog eats dirt sometimes. Are they? Yeah, dirt is, we eat it as kids. They'll be fine. Nematodes, where do you buy them? If you want to support Jeff Bezos, you would get them from Amazon. If you want to buy them locally, you can get them at pretty much any plant store. So Saskatoon Early's in Saskatoon sells these. Like I said, you can buy them on the internet. And then your nursery, like your local greenhouses, should have them. If they don't, give them trouble and tell them to get them in, because they are really, really valuable. I personally really like them. They got rid of all my ants in my front yard this year. So should I have my soil tested at a lab or DIY? Nothing's been growing for 2 years. Given wood ash, cow manure, eggshells, don't know what else to do. That's from Juliana. You know, I think if you're having a lot of issues like that, you could get it tested at a lab. You could perform some experiments on your own at home. But a really great starting point would be Googling what kind of soil is in your area. So doing a soil test, like a ribbon test it's called, with your soil, to actually determine what your soil type is, your texture is, and then going from there, trying to figure out how to amend that soil type. So this is kind of what a ribbon test looks like. You can see there's different lengths of ribbons. This is like clay loam, sandy loam, loamy sand. Go through, research that, look up ribbon test to test it, and then go from there. There's also the jar trick, like there's a sediment texture you can do as well that some people enjoy more. Me as a soil scientist prefer the ribbon test. It takes a little practice, but it's definitely useful. So healthy bug pests for control stuff. This is, you want to use the nematodes, lactobacillus, rhizobacterium. What was the other one? Bacillus thuringiensis. If you guys are taking notes, some of you are taking notes, I guess. So those are kind of the ones that you want to go for. Phosphate solubilizing. Amanda, I would like to know, love to know your opinion on liquid dirt. What do I have for time? Okay, it's still okay for time. Okay, so I would love to know your opinion on liquid dirt. So there's a lot of products out there, and this is one of them. They call them soil food, or plant food is what they call them. Liquid dirt is one that they call plant food too. I think there's Merrifil, and then there's BIOS. BIOS is a bit different though. And so these are called plant foods. And so plants don't take up carbohydrates, fats, or proteins. They take up 17 essential nutrients: nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, sulfur, boron, copper, iron. I mean, I can list them all off if you want to, but they don't even take them up in their single ion forms. In some cases, they take them up as, for example, nitrate, ammonium. Ammonium is not as easy to uptake. Phosphate things, they have oxygens attached to them. In the case of borons, irons, coppers, sulfurs, those are single ions. So they take up literal ionic molecules. They don't take up food. So what the food products do is, it's really hard to say what the food products do, but what I think they do is they add carbon, similar to that of a compost, a manure, a humic acid, which just in turn helps microbes flourish, which can help with nitrogen or nutrient cycling. And so I find with the houseplant community, you guys really, really like liquid dirt. You really like Super Thrive. So what I think is happening is you're letting your soil dry out too much and you're not making a home for microbes. And so when you start adding products like the Super Thrive or the liquid dirt, you are introducing microbiota and you're introducing microbiota friendly conditions. And so it's almost like a placebo effect. You get a new product, you're more likely to water. And so you're seeing really good results because you're finally actually taking care of your plants properly. If you don't want to buy the $54 jug of liquid dirt, for example, just use the compost, use the manures, humic acid, you don't even really have to use that. And then just really make sure you keep that soil moisture up and you're going to see the same results. Powdered lime. For whoever asked that question, they asked pelletized or powdered, and it is powdered lime that you need to use. Christopher over on Facebook asked, what's your opinion on the countertop compost machine, if you're aware of it? This is so funny. I keep on getting asked so many questions about that. I'm looking into it. I emailed the two companies that make it. The one is Ninja, and the other company, I can't remember what the name is. I've emailed them. I'm trying to figure out what the machine does. I don't know what it does yet, so I cannot answer that question. I believe it heats it up. I'm not entirely sure, though, so come back to the next live, ask that question again, and I may be able to answer that. I just emailed them yesterday, actually. Agricultural dolomite lime to add. I've added white lime. Dolomite lime is what you can add. Agricultural, I'm not sure what you're asking for that. Are you talking about like the chalk lime? Is that what you're asking? How do you mend soil that is very old? Hydrangea shrubs growing in it. So hydrangea is like really acidic soil, similar to that of the blueberries. Just compost, manure. You can only top dress. You can't actually get in there to amend it because you can't actually dig into it. So top dressing with something that's preferably manure, because you're going to have more micro. We have to move faster. Okay. Can you use mulch, fallen leaves as mulch? Yes, you can. There's no issue with that. You can shred them or you can leave them as is. Look up leaf composting specifically. It's really cool stuff. Use garbage bags. It's really, really easy to do. I have beneficial fish tank. You can add fish tank water. It's high in microbes, specifically nitrifying and denitrifying bacteria. Nitrifying bacteria is the stuff you want. It's really, really good at that. Can you tell us about the ice thing again? Can't remember what the ice thing was. I can't remember what that is. What book am I referring to? Oh, this is just, this is my book. It's not a book. It's a planner. It's just my planner. Okay, you can get them on Amazon or Etsy, whichever one you prefer. Shauna from Ontario. I cannot say the name of that town in Ontario. We have in our culture called the Three Sisters corn, beans, peas. We use these for different. The others, we have two different soil types available to us for gardening. First is, I've heard of the Three Sisters corn thing. I have heard of that. I don't know how or why, but replying back to your answer about dogs in soil. What about, oh, nematodes. Yeah, I have cats, dogs, I have a parrot. They're around this all the time. They can't crawl out. Like, you physically will never see what's in here. And nematodes, like I said, your skin, their skin's covered in them. So are nematodes safe? Yeah, again, your dogs aren't. Like, your dogs have millions of nematodes on them. So I think, do you guys have any other questions? Because I have gotten through all the questions. So if you guys have any more, please leave them in the comments down below. We are out of time, though, too. So I want to thank you guys so much for watching the Lee Valley Live. We are back again. We have another one. Add rice or just rice water to the compost? The rice water. So look up how to culture lactobacillus You're using rice to cultivate a water that is high in lactobacillus. So you're using the water as the inoculant in the compost or in the soil. And you can water your plants with this indoors too, or cannabis, whatever. When composting high carbon nitrogen ratio mulches, is there a fair amount of variation in the microbe that composts different wood mulches, such as poplar spruce? Yes, yeah, no. There, so the more diversity you add to both your compost, your soil, whatever the case is, you will end up with different forms of microbes. There's pretty much a microbe for anything. There's about five microbes for every biological process that takes place in your soil. So diversity is key. If you added sheep manure one year and mushroom compost one year, the next year you should do cow manure and leaf mold, for example, as something you can look at. So you mentioned the products that kill pests in soil can be bad for soil. Can you expand on this a bit? Can you so I don't like to use systemic pesticides per se. Neem is a systemic pesticide that you cannot purchase in Canada legally. It's not for sale here. There are neem-like products in Canada, but none of it's true neem. So none of it's going to work the way that you think it should. I've heard of people importing it from the US, but it's not something that Agri-Foods Canada has approved. So I avoid putting anything in my soil that's going to harm my soil. That includes pesticides, fungicides, bactericides, even hot waters. I don't sterilize my potting soils. I don't do any of that. Like, you need a microbially diverse soil. And so I add things like manures or whatever the case is. Again, it doesn't, a synthetic fertilizer or conventional fertilizer, it'll kill off, it's all about dosages, right? So if you put a little bit of Miracle-Gro in some water and you water your plants, is it going to kill off all the microbial community to the point that it won't be able to rebound? Probably not. But if you're watering with Miracle-Gro, you know, every 72 hours, or in the case for container gardeners, this may be the case. Every 72 hours, you're watering your plants with Miracle-Gro. Do you run the risk of a soil that's devoid of microbial activity? Yes, you do, because you need that 72 hours for that rebound to happen. So, just something to keep in mind there. My ants, I did the nemonites too, and slugs. I did the nemonites. I like their product. I think they're Canadian actually too. There's another one called Pot Poppers. I actually don't mind them either. I just don't have them here. So, inherited someone else's garden bed, community gardens in a apartment complex. What would be the best ways to make the soil better? I added sheep manure in the fall. Last year's veggies were underwhelming in growth. So if you inherited a new bed and you added manure and the growth was lackluster, I would first review on yourself, and that's why I use these journals. Like, I use like garden planners and journals, like garden journals. It's because you can document this stuff. So if you notice that the soil was drying out really often, it's a good sign of how to change it. My question would be, is it a raised bed? What's in it? Is there topsoil in it from maybe the backfilled land in the area? Or was their soil actually brought in for the purpose of gardening? Another thing I would look at, if you're really unsure of what's going on, you've added manure and nothing's working. And this goes for people who have a lot of issues with soil moisture and they feel like they're watering all the time, their watering bill is getting really, really high. You need to look into mycorrhizal fungi. There's endo and there's ecto varieties. You need to get the, you can get endo or ecto, it doesn't matter, but you need to get strains that are best for your crops you're growing, or a universal strain. So there is a universal form of endo mycorrhizal bacteria. It's made by mites. And it's actually the stuff that's in the HP Promix brand. It's the same fun or hyphae that's in there. use that. It's going to make a big, big difference for you. So ground eggshells, use this as a soil. Yeah, you can use ground eggshells as a soil amendment. Yeah. Don't put whole egg shells in your garden. It attracts mice. Just know from experience. Oh, flea beetles and cucumber bugs. So this isn't so much a soil thing for the flea beetles and the cucumber bugs. For those ones, I would probably get like praying mantises and stuff if you want to go like super organic. But netting is a great way to actually help curtail them. And then look at growing degree days for your area. The growing degree days it takes for that flea beetle to arrive, and then take all the precautions necessary before that day arrives. And if you need more information on that, then please reach out. So, but we are going to wrap this up. I want to thank you guys all for joining this Lee Valley Live. You can find me, myself, Ashley, the soil scientist, back here. I'll be back here February 10th, planning the science-based garden, and then I'll be back again on February 24th about the vermicompost. So the science-based gardening is going to be really cool. We're going to be talking about things like companion cropping, alleviating transplant shock, and how to actually plan out the number of plants you need and all that fun stuff. So if you want to be notified of the Lee Valley live stream, you want to make sure you follow them over on their Facebook page and register for those events through the Facebook page. So if you're watching this on YouTube or Twitch, you may not know this. Over on the Lee Valley Facebook page, you can actually sign up, get the alert so you know to show up, and then you can watch it on your preferred platform, whether it be Twitch or YouTube. And it also helps Lee Valley know how much you enjoy me and my information if you do. So I want to thank you guys all so much for hanging out with this Saskatchewan Redhead here today. If you guys have any questions, feel free to reach out to Lee Valley or myself. I want to thank you guys so much for watching, and I will definitely talk to you guys next time. Bye.